Divine Plan program presents The Beautiful Harmony of the Scriptures. Enjoy the rich experience of discovering the truth of the Bible. The Lord says, "Come, let us reason together."
The Divine Plan program presents Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now
because of Adam's disobedience, the entire human race was lost. Wars, famines, pestilences, and many other ills have hastened many at an early age to the end of the broad way, which is death. Over 4,000 years of sin, misery, heartaches, and woe had elapsed from the time Adam was sentenced to death and driven from his paradise home until the Almighty Creator sent his dear Son to earth to seek and to save that which was lost. At the first advent, our dear Redeemer gave a parable of a man leaving 99 sheep and going after the one which was lost.
Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness, and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance.
What is the meaning of this parable? The 99 sheep represented the spirit beings who had not wandered away from the Heavenly Father, but remained obedient. the Logos, the first and last direct creation of the Almighty Creator, is represented by the shepherd who left the 99 sheep and came to find the one that was lost. Amazing grace. The Redeemer came to earth to seek the lost sheep. This lost sheep represented Adam and his race in him, who had wandered away from the Creator into sin and death. Our dear Savior at the first advent became a man and gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. He was a corresponding price for Adam and all his race in him. Amazing grace. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to die for us. Our dear Redeemer died even for the malefactors who were crucified with him. From the degraded unto those not so vile, our dear Redeemer died for all.
And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, If thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom.
When the earthly phase of the kingdom is established, there will be much rejoicing. Both of the men crucified with our Lord will be remembered in due time and awakened from the sleep of death. Amazing grace. All mankind will have the opportunity to retrace all steps taken in the wrong direction after the highway of holiness is opened. Those who clean up from sin and its defilements and accept and obey the dear Redeemer will gain perfect human life. However, before our Lord uses the keys of death and Hades, that is, oblivion, the death state, to unlock the doors of the great prison house of death, set the prisoners free in an orderly manner, and start them up the highway of holiness, which leads to perfect human life, a few from the first advent until the present, who reverence the Heavenly Father, and exercise faith in the dear Redeemer, have the opportunity to walk in the narrow way which leads to a heavenly reward. Amazing grace. A few who now believe and make a full consecration to do the Heavenly Father's will after being called in the one hope of your calling, are begotten of the Spirit to the divine nature. The fully consecrated are walking in the narrow way, which leads to glory, honor, and immortality. Those who are faithful in carrying out their consecration, even unto death, the number being just a little flock, will be heirs of God and joint heirs with our Redeemer. Our Lord taught the necessity of a full consecration and faithfulness in carrying out our vow before the crown of life is given.
Consider the lilies, how they grow. They toil not, they spin not, and yet I say unto you that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothed the grass, which is today in the field and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O ye of little faith? And seek not ye what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, neither be ye of doubtful mind, for all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell that ye have, and give alms. Provide yourselves bags which wax not old, a treasure in the heavens that faileth not, where no thief approacheth, neither moth corrupteth. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also.
Paul also taught the necessity of setting our mind or affection on things above. In Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2 we read, If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. These admonitions apply only to those who are dead to human hopes, aims, and ambitions. As the next verse brings to our attention, we read, For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Those not invited to enter the narrow way, the number being a very large percentage of the human race, are not admonished to set their mind on things above. As previously noted, the world will have the opportunity of living here on the earth after the earthly phase of the kingdom is established. In order for one at that time to receive everlasting life, he must accept our Savior and obey the laws of the kingdom. However, at the present, while the door to the heavenly or high calling is still open, one who is called has the opportunity of giving all that he has to the Heavenly Father, and thus will lay up treasure in heaven, as explained by our Master at the First Advent.
And a certain ruler asked him, saying, Good Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, Why callest thou me good? None is good save one, that is God. Thou knowest the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, honor thy father and thy mother. And he said, All these have I kept from my youth up. Now when Jesus heard these things, he said unto him, Yet lackest thou one thing. Sell all that thou hast, and distribute unto the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me. And when he heard this, he was very sorrowful, for he was very rich. And when Jesus saw that he was very sorrowful, he said, How hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? For it is easier for a camel to go through a needle's eye than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. And they that heard it said, Who then can be saved? And he said, The things which are impossible with men are possible with God. Then Peter said, Lo, we have left all and followed thee. And he said unto them, Verily I say unto you, there is no man that hath left house or parents or brethren or wife or children for the kingdom of God's sake, who shall not receive manifold more in this present time and in the world to come life everlasting.
Those who are faithful to their consecration vows during the gospel age, the more than overcomers, will receive the highest form of life. The people on earth who pass over the highway of holiness, which will be opened during the mediatorial phase of the kingdom, and who pass the final examination during the little season, will gain everlasting life. During the gospel age, one who has given his all to the Heavenly Father receives it back and is tested to see how he will use it in God's service. Those who have riches, that is, wealth, education, influence, and the like, find it difficult to give these up. Jesus used the illustration of a camel going through a needle's eye to teach this lesson. In olden times, the owner of a camel loaded with merchandise or goods had to unload these if he wished to enter a city after the main gates had been closed for the night. By unloading the goods, the camel could kneel and enter into the city through a small gateway called the needle's eye. Whatever riches one may possess must be unloaded and used in the service of the Heavenly Father in order to lay up treasure in heaven. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 26 through 28, Paul reminds us that not many well-born ones, though there are some, are called to the high calling. It is mainly the low-born ones who are chosen to walk in the footsteps of the Master. Jesus also taught the same lesson. Those who recognize their need of the Redeemer and accept the call to walk in the narrow way, being faithful unto death, will receive the kingdom.
And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for ye shall be filled. Blessed are ye that weep now, for ye shall laugh. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice ye in that day, and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. For in the like manner did their fathers unto the prophets.
Those walking in the footsteps of the Redeemer will experience reproaches and difficulties, as taught by the Master. But amazing grace, the dangers, toils, and snares of the narrow way are more than offset by the grace which is given to the consecrated. The signs in the earth indicate that soon the bride will have made herself ready, and the full union of the bride to the heavenly bridegroom will take place. Only a little flock of 144,000 members will constitute the bride. Shortly after the full union of our Lord and His bride, the call will go forth to the world to partake of the water of life freely. Amazing grace. The whole world of mankind will be offered life, made possible because of the costly sacrifice of our dear Redeemer. The major portion of the thousand-year reign of Christ has been set aside for the work of restoring all the willing and obedient to what Adam lost, life, and his paradise home. What will be the work of the Christ, head and body members, beyond the Messianic age? Amazing grace. These, styled the Son of Righteousness, will continue to do the Father's will, singing God's praise, not only for the first 10,000 years, but for all eternity. Will you spend eternity in heaven or on earth? Why will only 144,000 plus our bridegroom receive the divine nature? Who will receive everlasting life? Why will the ones who refuse to accept and obey the dear Redeemer in their due time be destroyed in the second death, but not tormented? Find answers to these and many other Bible questions in The Divine Plan of the Ages. A free copy will be sent to each one requesting it. In addition to sending a copy of The Divine Plan of the Ages to each one who writes, the sponsors of the Divine Plan program will also send a free printed copy of today's lesson Amazing Grace, lesson number 170. Please ask for lesson number 170. Invite your friends to also tune in each week to the Divine Plan program. Goodbye until next week at the same time, and may God bless you.
For the free literature offered on the Divine Plan program, please phone the sponsors at 1-800-8-DIVINE. The number again is 1-800-8-DIVINE. Rightly divide the word of truth by studying the Bible topically and dispensationally. Please phone us at 1-800-8-DIVINE or write to Divine Plan, Post Office Box 4085, Fort Worth, Texas, 76164. May you be blessed as you study the divine plan of the ages.